I have to my credit more than 28 years of experience in teaching and research. I joined this institution in 1992 after working for about 2.5 years in industries and 7 years in a college of education, and have guided 28 PhD dissertations registered with Punjab University Chandigarh, and I have been coordinating number of short-term courses and long-term courses. Now coming to today's important theme, friends, many of us have strong inherent desire for teaching. Some are already practicing in the profession, others are just beginning to learn fundamentals, because many of you have just joined the teaching profession and many are also already practicing in the profession. Now two issues come to our mind. How do teachers develop competencies necessary for successful teaching? What knowledge, skills and attitude must they acquire, and what capabilities do they need to develop in order to become effective teachers? You will agree with me that much of the successful instruction is the result of competent planning and delivery of instruction. It means teachers have to arrange instructional events for students in such a way that effective learning is facilitated. And these events of instruction must be carefully designed in advance if learning or if instruction is to be effective. So competent planning and delivery of instruction allow for efficient organization and presentation of instructional events, and therefore these are very, very essential for effective teaching. So today's session is about planning and delivering effective instruction. So obviously we will focus on two aspects. One is competent planning and second is effective delivery. Now planning, when they say plan, a plan of actions of what a person has to do. And when it comes to instructional planning, it means plan of actions of what a teacher has to do in the classroom. It means planning what to do and what not to do in the classroom. So lesson planning or instruction planning is the teaching outline of important points of a lesson arranged in the order in which they are to be presented. It may include objectives to be achieved, points to be made, amount of content matter to be covered, kind of questions to be asked, reference to media, assignment, textbook, etc. So in nutshell, we can say that it is an organized statement of both general and specific goals together with specific means by which these goals are to be attained by the students under the guidance of a teacher on a given day. So it's a sort of daily, you can say, planning, daily instructional planning, which involves defining objectives, determining the content or determining the methods and procedure. Now in this particular statement, you will notice that there are general goals and specific goal, or general objective and specific objective. For example, the topic is, say, Ohm's law. So for this, the general objective would be, after the topic is over, students will be able to understand Ohm's law, or they will be able to know Ohm's law. This is very broad. Now how this can be measured? Now if I ask, what do you understand by Ohm's law, or what do you know about Ohm's law, obviously you will get different responses from different students, and even a single answer sheet will carry different marks, because the teacher will evaluate whatever is in his or her mind. Now these are not very, very specific. Now specific goals could be that after the topic is over, students will be able to define current, they will be able to name the device which measure current, they will be able to state the SI unit of current, they will be able to draw the circuit diagram for verification of Ohm's law. They will be able to verify Ohm's law. They will be able to draw a graph between V and I, and they will be able to list situations where Ohm's law can be applicable. So I have used the terms like define, state, name, draw, list. Okay, these are very, very specific, and these lead to the attainment of general goal, that is, they will be able to understand Ohm's law, or they will be able to know about Ohm's law. And specific means methodology, method of teaching, media, evaluation technique. So this instructional planning attempts to answer three questions. One is, where am I going? That is, what are the objectives of today's instruction? Objectives, I say objective or instruction objective, is a sentence or statement which what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. Now, in other days, when we ask teacher, what is your goal? He says, my goal is to enable my students understand, or to enable my students know. Now, these are teacher's objective. Now, there is a shift from teacher-centered teaching to student-centered learning. That is what they will be able to do. I say, after the topic is over, my student will be able to define, explain, describe, and so on. Okay. So, second is, how will I get there? Method of teaching, media, evaluation technique. So, a proper match between the content, the objectives, method of teaching, instructional media will facilitate optimal learning. And the third one is, how will I know when I have arrived? Means, I will ask few questions, and the answer to those questions will give me an idea about to what extent my students are receiving the information, or they are understanding it, or they are doing, they are able to define, explain, and describe, so on. Now, let us move to the significance of instructional planning. Firstly, ensures presentation of content matter in a logical, systematic, and effective way. Logical, systematic. That is, we prepare our lecture plan on the basis of some of the psychological principles or maxims of teaching, like we proceed from, say, simple to difficult, or we proceed from known to unknown, because known thing is easily accepted by the student. We always begin with known, what they already know, and then slowly we move to what they do not know. Thirdly, proceed from concrete to abstract. Concrete, something which is composed of many muscles. Abstract, something which is reduced to summary. So we need to concretize an abstract idea. Okay. So you need to give a lot of examples to make it more meaningful. And another principle is, proceed from observation to reasoning. That is, let them observe many situations, and then you may ask them to give the generalization. So content is presented in a logical, systematic, and in a very effective way. So since the content is logical, systematic, so it checks haphazard way of teaching. It keeps the teacher on the track. So he will move in a very systematic way. And since he has prepared his lecture plan, so he can also anticipate the likely question that the student may ask from him. So that will give him confidence. Enables the teacher to achieve economy of time, effort, and money. You have prepared your lecture plan. It will be conducted in a very smooth manner. Students will be able to grasp the meaning of the material. So time is saved, effort is saved. In regard to money, teacher has brought some media on rent, and he has not properly integrated while teaching, money part will also go waste. Another is, develop self-confidence because he knows in advance what to do and what not to do. So you are very, very confident. Ensures proper use of instruction media when the need arises. You will show only when it is needed and you will remove it when it is not needed. You have prepared PowerPoint presentation, but you have not linked it with animations. So the complete slide will come in one, go. And you are not explaining the other parts, but the students are noting down the other parts. So you have to use it when it is needed. Another significance is that while preparing your lecture plan, you also think about the examples from the students' daily life and examples from the world of work. So in this way, you are able to apply student learning in a new setting. So that will help the student retain the information for a longer period because a transfer of learning has taken place. It ensures the teacher to evaluate his lecture as the lesson proceeds and thus reveals his or her personality. So you can note down the facial reading of your student. You can go for sectional evaluation, that is after completing one component you may ask one or two questions, then second component, third component, at the end you may ask the question pertaining to the entire, you can say, content. Now let us move to the components of instruction planning. One is specifying instructional objectives. As I told you in the beginning, instructional objective is a sentence or a statement which describes what the student will be able to do at the end of a unit of instruction. When I say after the topic is over, students will be able to know force, or they will be able to understand the concept of force. Now this is a broad objective. So we may say it is a general objective. Then the specific objective. He will be able to define force. He will be able to state SI unit of force. He will be able to differentiate between two types of forces and so on. So differentiate, state, define, name, all these are very, very specific objectives. And we will study it deeply. Then after the objectives are specifically stated out, the next task required of the teacher is to select the content matter to achieve the objective, amount of content matter. That is a very important thing. Carrying out task analysis. After the content is selected, the next task required of the teacher is to analyze the topic into its constituent parts. Task analysis is actually a process of describing the complexity of an activity into easier steps. These steps are then organized in a sequence and students are taught those steps one by one in the sequence. So I'll give you an illustration how the content can be analyzed into its constituent parts. Then specifying instructional method. Instruction method, the purpose is to link between a teaching input and learning outcomes, mainly in terms of realizing learning outcomes. And as you know, large number of instruction methods are available, and it will be incorrect to select a single method of instruction which can be employed for teaching of various subjects in the engineering institution, because there are differences in the nature of objective. There are differences in the students, needs. So you need to select a method which is most suitable in a particular situation. Selecting or developing instructional media. Instructional media refer to both print and non-print. So we may have charts, pictures, diagram, PowerPoint presentation, video program, audio lectures. So the teacher has to select, keeping in mind some of the factors like nature of the students, nature of the subject, mode of presentation, size of the class, practical constraints, or budgetary, you can say, constraints. So these are considered so that the optimal learning could take place. Then deciding about evaluation procedure. By evaluation, we mean those activities which are designed to measure student achievement brought about as a result of some instructional unit. And performance objective or instruction objective forms the basis for writing the items of the you can say evaluation. For example, if the objective is that he will be able to define force, then corresponding question would be define force and not what is force, what do you mean by force, what do you know about force, because what do you mean by force, what is force, or what do you know about force, these are measuring something different, whereas our objective is that he or she will be able to define force. So here comes the two important characteristics of evaluation. One is the validity, second is the reliability. Now, what is validity? We say a test is valid if it measures what it is supposed to measure. Okay, so if the objective is that he or she will be able to define force, then obviously the question would be define force and not what is force, because there what is force and define force, so there is a lot of gap. Likewise, reliability. Reliability refers to consistency of results from one measurement to another measurement. That is, if one question is asked to a number of students and they are able to give similar kind of response, then there is a consistency. You see, if I ask, what do you know about Ohm's law? Now, this question would be interpreted differently by different students. They will give different responses. When I say, explain the working principle of carburetor of an IC engine. Now, although this is very specific, but one student gives the working principle, second student explains the working principle with a neat sketch. Now the teacher will give more marks to the student who has explained the working principle with a neat sketch. So why can't we include this word neat sketch in the statement of the question so that everybody should interpret in the same way? Now the question is, what are Newton's laws of motion? Now here again there is a problem. One student gives only the statement of three laws. Second student only describes about gives a description about two laws. Another student gives examples of each of these three laws. Now can't we write the statement like, describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example? Now in this particular statement of the question, scope of the topic to be discussed is clearly indicated and the nature of student response is also given. Describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example. So the teacher has to think about the evaluation procedure, and finally he has to prepare a lecture plan. What is the format of a lecture plan? We will discuss. Now, first of all, instructional objectives. So these attempt to answer three questions. One is, define what must be learned. Secondly, what instruction method and media, because the selection depends upon the type of the or the nature of the instruction objective, and provide assistance in planning the assessment procedure. Now you see, the broad purpose of the technical education system is all-round development of personality. So developing student personality in an all-round means developing their capabilities in the intellect and non-intellect areas, which are concerned with knowledge, skill, and attitude. So knowledge comes under cognitive domain, which is concerned with knowledge, understanding, application, analysis, problem solving, etc. Affective domain is concerned with our attitudes, our feelings, our interest, our emotions. So the second domain. Third domain, psychomotor. Mind, motor means muscles. So hand and head coordination. So they're like setting up a lathe or loading a film in the camera, all these come under the psychomotor domain. These have got different levels. So in this particular session, we will focus on the cognitive domain, which begins with the lowest level, that is the remembering, that is recall of previously learned material. He will be able to name, state, factual, okay, basic terminology. Name the device which measures current. It is, you can say, give one example of a particular thing, okay. So it means only the naming part or the basic terminology. Higher level is understanding, that is explaining ideas or concept, that is when the student will be able to grasp the meaning of the material. So the action verbs which are used for writing objectives at this level include classify, convert, define, describe, estimate, explain, express. Describe each of three Newton's laws of motion with one example. Explain with a neat sketch the working principle of carburetor of an IC engine. Okay, so these are the objective. Then the third one is applying. Application means students' ability to apply whatever they have learned in a familiar situation or in a different situation. So the verbs used are adapt, apply, calculate, change, compute, etc. So these are the action verbs which can be used to write objectives or to write items at this level. After he has understood the application, the next he can be involved in critical thinking, that is breaking down something into its constituent parts and looking into various relationships. So these are the action verbs which can be used for writing items at this level. Then another is evaluation, evaluating, again critical thinking, but at this time he is able to give the judgment or you can say justify a decision. So appraise, assess, choose, compare, conclude, decide, and so on. And last but the highest level is creating, again critical thinking, but at this stage he is able to generate new idea, new product, or ways of viewing things differently. So these are the action verbs which can be used for writing items at this particular level. Now we'll move to the task analysis. As I told you in the beginning, that it is a process of breaking down the complexity of an activity into easier steps. So process of breaking down or analyzing a task into easier or smaller and more detailed constituent units, and of then sequencing these units of analysis in order of priority based upon their importance in learning. So involves analysis and synthesis. Let me give you an illustration. Task could be any topic, say Ohm's law, or solving simultaneous equation. Task could be any job, like setting up a lathe, loading a film in a camera. Whereas skill is a very simple act. It is a further extension of job. It has no structure. It doesn't involve any problem solving. So skill is a small act. So for teaching, say, any topic or any job or any skill, say any topic is there. For this, teacher has to explain this. These are the five units which the teacher has to explain for enabling the student to learn something. Now again, this is further analyzed at the second level. For this, teaching this, teacher has to explain this. For teaching this, teacher has to explain these five units. Now again, it can be broken down into different levels. For teaching this, he has to explain this. For explaining this, teacher has to explain this. And you will notice that at the top, the content was less detailed, and at the bottom, the content is totally, you can say, detailed. So it means for teaching this thing, teacher needs not explain anything else. Let me give you an example. Say job of an engine mechanic. We can classify into, say, these five jobs: tuning the carburetor, adjusting tappets, adjust spark plug gap, changing engine oil, cleaning the spark plug. Now again, these activities can be further broken down into sub activities. Let us take one of them: changing engine oil. So first of all, the student has to jack up the car, place oil container under the sump, remove sump plug, and allowing oil to drain away. Now let us analyze it further. Say jacking up the car, the task elements could be acquiring right kind of jack, positioning the jack, and manipulating the jack. And if you require more analysis, you can further break down into its constituent parts. Okay, this is task analysis, and I think this is a very wonderful you can say tool in the hands of the teacher. So this one page task analysis can be taken to the class, and teacher need not carry or take the large class notes in the, so he can develop his lecture with the help of this task analysis. Now before preparing a lecture plan, teacher needs to understand the general principles of planning. One is, acquire a sound knowledge of curriculum requirements and content. Students learn most from those teachers who have a complete understanding, a thorough understanding of the content of the curriculum and the curriculum required. So first duty is to study the content deeply. Second is, plan instruction on the basis of what your students actually know and understand, and not on an assumption of what they should have learned in the previous lecture or previous you can say semester. Students are disadvantaged by those teachers who assume that they have complete understanding of the content of previous lecture. So always begin with what they already know, and then slowly move to what they do not know. Now let me give you an illustration. If I say, today I am going to talk to you about inertia, today I will discuss about inertia, today I will teach you about inertia, I think this kind of introduction is very vague, very incorrect. Otherwise student will see, say, sir, this is your headache, please go and break your head. Now let me give you an illustration. I ask, what is the position of this object? Is it at rest or is it moving? Definitely they will say that, sir, this is at rest. On switching on the fan, what is the position of this fan? They will say it is in motion. Wonderful. Now this is at rest. How can it be made into action? They will say by pushing or by pulling, that is by applying some force, it can be into action. You are sitting in a moving bus and the driver suddenly applies brakes. What happens? Obviously, they have already experienced, they will say, sir, we will fall forward. And what happens when the driver suddenly starts the bus? We go backward. Why are these due to? Now, everybody is very much curious to know the reason Now it is very interesting to you can say it will be very much interesting for him. Now is the time to introduce your lecture. These are due to laws of inertia. So today in this session we will learn laws of inertia. Never say I will teach, I will discuss, I'm going to talk to you, because in today's context no one has complete authority on anything. Okay. So I'm also learning along with you, because you also possess some knowledge, you are also contributing, so I'm also learning. Let me give you another illustration. What are the constituents of air? I'll get answer like oxygen, nitrogen, carbon dioxide gas, carbon monoxide gas, etc. Which gas do we inhale? Obviously, the answer would be oxygen. Which gas do we exhale? Carbon dioxide. Wonderful. Which gas is available in soda water bottle? So carbon dioxide. Wonderful. Which gas is used to extinguish fire? Carbon dioxide gas. Wonderful. So friends, carbon dioxide gas has got various advantages. How this gas can be prepared? Now everybody is curious, very, very attentive. Now you say carbon dioxide gas can be prepared by treating calcium carbonate with hydrochloric acid. So today in this session we will learn preparation of carbon dioxide. Never say I will teach carbon dioxide gas. So plan instruction on the basis of what your student actually know and understand. Prepare specific instruction objectives for every lesson. As I told you in the beginning, that you begin your objective with verb like define, explain, describe, and so on. Select instruction strategies that are appropriate for the topic to be taught and aptitude of the learner, and always also plan for the alternatives. Suppose I have brought PowerPoint presentation and I'm very much confident that today I will enable them understand with the help of this PowerPoint presentation. Now as I start using PowerPoint presentation, electricity goes off, or say PPT doesn't open the file or CD doesn't open the file. So I will smile at them. Okay, we'll learn tomorrow. This is wrong. I must say. Okay, no problem. I can develop my lecture on the chalkboard. So we must have some alternative, you can say, for our lecture. Plan a beginning, a middle, and a conclusion for all lesson. Beginning. Beginning is like the warm-up phase of your presentation. So it must fire the imagination of your students. I have given you two illustrations, one about the laws of inertia and secondly about the preparation of carbon dioxide gas. Ek main aur aapko deta hun. Pani se barf kaise banti hai? Aap bolenge isko refrigerator mein rakhne se. Wonderful. Barf se phir pani kaise banta hai? Bahar nikalne pe ya usko heat karne pe. Wonderful. Doodh se dahi kaise banta hai? थोड़ा सा खट्टा डालेंगे, दही डालेंगे और उसको कुछ देर के लिए रखेंगे, और दही से दोबारा दूध कैसे बनता है? ऑब्वियस आंसर वुड बी सर, नहीं बनता. नाउ पानी का बर्फ बनना और बर्फ का फिर से पानी बन जाना, लेकिन दूध का दही तो बनना, दही से दोबारा दूध ना बनना, ऐसा क्यों होता है? नाउ एवरीबॉडी इज नाउ क्यूरियस टू नो अबाउट इट. देन यू से दैट दीज आर ड्यू टू physical and chemical changes taking place in the matter. So today in this session we will learn the concept of physical and chemical change. Abhi dekhiye is content topic ko padhane ke liye, halanki ye 6th class ke bachon ka topic hai, inertia wala 7th class ke bachon ka topic hai. Agar main aate bolta ki sir bacho aaj main aapko inertia padhaunga, inertia word is very unfamiliar for them, they will not accept it easily. तो मैंने उनको जो कल पढ़ाया था रेस्ट मोशन और फोर्स, वहां से उसको लिंक किया, डेली लाइफ के एग्जांपल से मैं एक सिचुएशन क्रिएट की. सो बिगिनिंग मस्ट इंक्लूड टू एक्टिविटीज, वन इज रिव्यू ऑफ प्रीरिक्विजिट्स एंड सेकंड इज ओवरव्यू ऑफ योर लेक्चर. ओके, then a middle imparting instruction, speaking or asking question, responding to student's answer or responding to student's question, writing on chalkboard, using PowerPoint presentation or integrating some charts, model, picture, etc. And a conclusion will include the summarization of whatever you have covered, followed by few questions. Then you can give them some kind of homework or assignment. Plan interesting and meaningful learning experiences, challenging learning experiences. So try to give them. Plan for meaningful learning. Meaningful learning takes place when the student is able to associate whatever he is receiving with his or her background experiences or some examples from daily life. So that will promote meaningful learning. And planned assignment that contain both easy and difficult material graded to student abilities. There are wide individual differences in regard to their intelligence. There are above average students, below average students. So always ask a very simple question to a very below average student. The idea is to boost his or her morale. Perhaps next time he will have some courage to answer somewhat difficult question. Organize a regular assessment schedule. You may cover some part, ask one or two questions, then again come to this second aspect of your lecture, again ask one or two questions, and before leaving the classroom, you may ask questions pertaining to the entire chapter. And be prepared to adapt plans that do not achieve stated objective. Now let us move to events of instruction. Very, very essential, very important. And you will find that these events of instruction must be carefully designed so that effective learning takes place. One is gaining attention. Purpose is to alert the students to the reception of the stimulus. And attention in general can be gained by rapid introduction of stimulus change. So I think this gaining attention is throughout, and it has got different tactics. One is generally teacher stands stationary at the lecture stand and he goes on explaining. आप मुझे इस एंगल से देख रहे हैं, आप मुझे इस एंगल से देख रहे हैं. सिंस देयर इज नो चेंज इन माय पोस्चर, नेचुरली देयर विल बी नो चेंज इन योर पोस्चर एंड यू विल टॉलरेट मी फॉर सम टाइम. आफ्टर दैट यू विल एक्सपीरियंस फटीग. सो इंस्टेड ऑफ स्टैंडिंग स्टेशनरी, अभी हालांकि मुझे एक ही जगह पर खड़े होने के लिए फोकस किया गया, मेरे ऊपर कैमरा फोकस्ड है, सो आई कैन नॉट मूव हियर एंड देयर. लेकिन क्लासरूम में आप पढ़ाते हुए स्लोली इस तरफ जाएं. You can go closer to the student, or in between agar passage hai, you can go inside. So never stand stationary at one point. So one tip is purposeful movements, but not very fast moving forward and backward. Okay. So purposeful movement. Secondly, teachers stand like this. Ya unko unke pocket jo hands hai unke pockets mein hai. Ya is tarah se khade hai. I say, in front of my house, there is a big house. Now, I will repeat it. In front of my house, there is a big house. Meaningful gestures. Okay. This also supplements whatever you are explaining. Third one is change of voice. Where you want to give some, you can say, emphasis, you can speak that word very loudly. These are due to laws of inertia. So, laws of inertia. Or due to, so you can give some pause also. Change interactional pattern. Instead of giving the lecture, you can say continuously, you insert few questions or invite few questions. Now they will participate, because psychology says that students learn best and retain for a longer period of time when they are involved. I'll say usually I use say to my students, students' expectation is, he says, if you tell me, I will forget. Another student says, if you show me, I may remember. And there are some students who say, if you involve me, I will be always with you. So student participation is very, very essential. Another is oral visual switching, A-U-R-A-L. Oral involves sense of hearing. Visual involves sense of sight. So switch over from one mode to another mode. And another component of gaining attention is giving your glance, maintaining an eye contact with each and every student sitting in the classroom. Because normally we have noticed that when the teacher teaches in the classroom, he focuses on the front bench and the back benchers are ignored. So you have to maintain an eye contact with each and every, otherwise they will be indulging themselves in some kind of daydreaming. So gaining attention, I think it should be throughout. Second is informing students about objectives of instruction, because students want to know why they are sitting in the classroom. So that why part must be communicated to them in the beginning. Then wo jo main objectives hain unko board pe bhi likhiye, left hand side pe. जैसे मैंने अभी आपको बताया, मैंने एक नीड क्रिएट की कि कार्बन डाइऑक्साइड गैस जो है उसकी बहुत इम्पोर्टेंस है और हम जानना चाहते हैं कि इसको कैसे बनाया जाए. तो आज हम लर्न करेंगे फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल द रिएक्टेंट्स, द लेबोरेटरी सेटिंग ऑफ द ऑपरेटर्स. आप लेफ्ट हैंड साइड पे बुलेट फॉर्म में आप इसको लिखेंगे. प्रिकॉशंस टू बी ऑब्जर्व, प्रोसीजर फॉर प्रेपरेशन, physical properties, chemical properties, advantages and disadvantages. So it means you first of all inform your students about the objectives of instruction. Then ensuring prerequisites of learner, what they already know, try to link it with today's topic. Presenting stimulus material, there must be some variety. Providing learning guidance, this is given when the student is unable to answer a question. Say you have asked one question, student is unable to answer. The idea is to break down that question into small 2-3 questions. The idea is to give them some kind of hint or clue ताकि वो answer देने के लिए courage उठा पाए. ये तब दे सकते हैं जब आपने कोई exercise दिया, numerical करने के लिए घर में दिए, तो आप कह सकते हो क्लू है इसमें. देन एलिसिटिंग परफॉर्मेंस मींस आस्किंग हिम टू शो, यस प्लीज कम एंड सॉल्व द प्रॉब्लम ऑन द चॉकबोर्ड, यस शो मी कि आपने किस तरह का डायग्राम बनाया. प्रोवाइडिंग इंफॉर्मेटिव फीडबैक इमीडिएटली, यहां पर लाइन थोड़ी सी आपकी टेढ़ी रहेगी, इसको थोड़ा सा ऐसे करना चाहिए था. सो इंफॉर्मेटिव फीडबैक गिव देम इमीडिएटली एंड देन असेसिंग स्टूडेंट परफॉर्मेंस. सो यू कैन थिंक अबाउट sectional evaluation or you can give them some quiz at the end of your lecture. And finally, give them assignment by which they will be able to apply whatever they have learned in the classroom in a new setting or in a familiar situation. So once they are able to apply or transfer from one form to another, that information will be retained by them for a longer period of time. So these are 9 events of instruction which the teacher must design while making a presentation in the class. Now the format of a lesson plan, various formats are available and we have prepared the format which can be used appropriately by teachers of technical institutions. So topic, name of the teacher, subject, class, place and date. Okay, then comes the instruction objectives, general objectives, specific objectives, and then the readiness objectives. Now, readiness objectives, what is the difference between general, specific, and readiness objective? You see, topic is Ohm's law. The general objective is after the topic is over, students will be able to understand Ohm's law, or they will be able to know Ohm's law. So I have used the term understand or know. The specific objective, they will be able to draw circle diagram, relationship, they will be able to verify Ohm's law, or they will be able to list situation. Now, what are the readiness objectives? We want to know what the student already knows. Number, he can define current. He can state SI unit of current. So he can readiness objective. Whether the student is ready to receive new instruction or not. Then you will prepare a five column format: phase, objective, instruction activities, media, and time. Introduction is the phase. Instruction activity means describe activities that explain the relevance of learning, the content of the lesson, and what is to be learned in the lesson. Yeah, list activities that may arouse curiosity of learning the content, or write activities that will test the presence of prerequisites in the students. And then you can give a reference of a media and how much time you require for teaching, developing introduction. You can make a mention of rough estimate of the time. Then state the objective one. Describe the strategy, not the content. Describe the strategy of presenting the information in respect of the objective to be achieved. Write the activities for assessing the achievement of objectives. Then make a mention of the media and how much time you require for developing first objective you can give. Then second objective, third objective, and so on. And at the end is the last phase, closure. List activities for summarizing, evaluating, and follow-up. And the timing column gives an indication of the pacing of the lesson. So you have prepared lecture plan, you have delivered in the classroom, go back to your room, introspect to what extent your lesson has been successful or effective. So note down the changes you wish to include in your future lecture or the same lecture in the next year. Now the second component is about delivery of instruction. Now, as I told you in the beginning, your lecture must contain three phases. One is the introduction, second is the development, and third one is the consolidation. So introduction is like the warm-up phase of your lecture, so it must fire the imagination of your students. So state objectives clearly and use advanced organizer to build a gap between what the student already knows and what he needs to do. So need or significance of that particular topic must be communicated to them. Development phase will include mainly two activities: explanation and demonstration. So explanation is a comprehensive exposition that increases students' understanding of the subject matter. So when you are explaining, always try to use the explaining links or associate with examples from their daily life. Give lot of examples, and you can also give them some kind of demonstration. Demonstration can be through media or it can be through some examples. So these will help the student learn the content very effectively. There are some other activities which the teacher can undertake. One is questioning. Of course, questioning has got various applications. One is you can focus attention of your student to particular aspects of the content matter. It will facilitate communication. You can evaluate students' knowledge and understanding of the subject matter. It will help you stimulate their thinking, or it will help you to control their unsocial behavior in the classroom. You may point out, yes, you can answer this question. If he is, if you have seen him talking to some other student. Now, questioning is a skill, so you need to know what questions to ask, how to ask questions, and how to respond to to students answer. So what questions to ask? Relevant to instructional objectives. Secondly, ask questions pertaining to different levels of difficulty. And thirdly, use familiar language. Don't use very hi-fi words, because our purpose is to make them understand. Not the purpose is to impress upon the students with the use of bombastic language. So always use language in which your students can understand. How to ask question? One is one question at a time. No two, three questions in one sentence. Secondly, question should be phrased from simple to difficult. And thirdly is that you address the question to all. Let them give some, few seconds to think about the answer. Let them raise their hand, and then you can call upon a particular student to answer the question and give them some time. And how to respond to student answer? Wonderful, you have said very rightly. You have given a partial answer. Can any one of you give the complete answer? This is how you will respond to student's answer. Then another is assigning homework or classroom task for practice. It should be meaningful and related to instruction objectives, and you always give hint if it is required. Motivation and reinforcement is very, very essential. Generally, teachers ask a typical question, what can we do to motivate students to learn? Question is simple, but the answer is not straightforward, because the typical procedures that the teachers employ for motivating students are very often indirect and subtle. So teacher needs to understand the difference between intrinsic and extrinsic motivation, and the stimulus response reinforcement, because stimulus is always followed by a response, and response must be followed by a desirable consequence. Only then he or she will be able to give answer for the next question. And teacher needs to know various techniques of motivating students, and involving their participation, setting smart goals, gaining their attention, recall of prerequisites, okay, or giving them immediate feedback, smiling at them, giving them lot of examples. These are so many techniques which can be used for motivating the students. The last phase is the consolidation phase, where the teacher is required to summarize whatever he has covered in the classroom, and then he has to provide them feedback and take corrective actions wherever the students are unable to understand. So this is all about the instruction planning and delivery. If you have some questions, you are welcome. So I'm here to answer to your questions. So audience and various institution, if you have any question, you are welcome. Yes.
If any center want to ask the question, that center can switch on their mic and ask the question.
Okay. If there is no question, so we will break for lunch, and we will be at Haji.
Is there any question from RIMT Govindgarh?
There is one question. Sir, Abhishek sir, running over as we are thinking over. Just please wait. Anybody?
Sir, audio is not into us.
So please repeat the question. Okay.
My question is that for engineering institute, the aspects according to technical education, we have improved some kind of new aspects, but the students related to training
So what is your question?
Training data queries and we are faced in the first year sessions, the first year students.
आप हिंदी या पंजाबी में बोलिए
सर. वो मैडम कह रहे हैं कि फर्स्ट ईयर में बच्चे पूछते हैं कि लैब में ये चीजें हमारी आगे ट्रेनिंग में कहाँ काम आएंगी, क्या हम ट्रेनिंग कैसे लें बाद में जाकर, ऐसे यही पूछने चाहते हैं. सर ये पूछने चाहते हैं कि फर्स्ट ईयर में बच्चों को कैसे बताया जाए कि फिजिक्स लैब में ये जो एक्सपेरिमेंट्स किए जा रहे हैं ये ट्रेनिंग में उनकी आगे 2-3 सालों में आगे या फिर इंडस्ट्री में कहाँ काम आएंगी ये चीजें फिजिक्स लैब में.
जो मैंने आपको ये सेशन था, दिस इज अबाउट इंस्ट्रक्शनल प्लानिंग एंड डिलीवरी. तो ये प्लान वो आप काम आएगी और उसको कवर करने के लिए पहले प्लानिंग बहुत जरूरी होती है. और आप लकी हैं, आपके पास मिस्टर हरमीत सिंह भीसा है जो यहाँ से एमटेक इंजीनियरिंग एजुकेशन करके गए हैं एंड प्रोबेबली ही विल बी एबल टू गिव यू द यू कैन से राइट यू कैन से पर्सपेक्टिव. और मुझे आपका क्वेश्चन अभी
हेलो